Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back to our Department of Medicine Academic Fees. Today, we have with us Dr. Biju George. Sir is the head and professor of Department of Hematology, Christian Medical College, Vellore. Sir will be taking this lecture for today on the topic approach to bone marrow failure. Sir's areas of interest is in bone marrow failure disorders, hemoglobinopathies, infections following chemotherapy and stem cell transplant, alternate donor transplantations. He has more than 200 publications in various national and international peer-reviewed journals. He is also a reviewer for various journals, as mentioned here. And sir has also written 5 textbook chapters. He also has given around 185 talks delivered in multiple forums. Sir, welcome again. And we are very much grateful to have you here for taking lectures for us. This lecture is mainly meant for our PGs, but then it's open to all who are interested in the same. This lecture will soon be uploaded on our Department of Medicine YouTube website. So anyone who misses out on it, please feel free to share this message on this lecture being available on our Department YouTube website. Also, if anyone have any questions, please feel free to ask sir or put down the chat box. Thanks again, sir, for agreeing to take this lecture for us, and over to you, sir.
Thank you. So what I hope to do with the next 45 minutes to 1 hour is to talk about bone marrow failure syndromes and 3 to 4 different aspects of bone marrow failure syndromes. So what are these bone marrow failure syndromes? They are a group of disorders where a stem cell defect, and this could either be congenital or acquired, could result in failure of one or more of the hematopoietic lineage. So the important things to remember is that it could involve either one lineage or multiple lineages, and this could either be congenital or acquired. So if you look at different lineages and kind of disorders that are involved in them, if you take the red cell lineage or red cell aplasia, you have the inherited form, which is the diamond black fin, and you have the acquired form, which is the pure red cell aplasia. Similarly, for neutropenia, you have Kosman's and Schwann diamond syndrome, while you have cyclical neutropenia and acquired. You have amegakinesthetic thrombocytopenia with absent radii in the inherited. And importantly, when you look at pancytopenia, which means more than 2 lines which are involved, it's 2 or 3, you have Fanconi anemia and dyskeratosis congenita, which are the common inherited bone marrow failure syndromes, while you have aplastic anemia, myelodysplastic syndrome, and PNH, which are the common acquired syndromes. Now, one of the most important things to remember as a MD physician is that pancytopenia is not synonymous with aplastic anemia. So if you look at this, this is a textbook article which talks about all the various causes of pancytopenia. You have here pancytopenia with the hypocellular marrow, which could either be aplastic anemia or inherited forms. You have pancytopenia with the cellular marrow, which is mainly a myelodysplastic syndromes. And you look at secondary effects of pancytopenia, which could be drugs, which could be things like benzene, cytotoxic agents, irradiation. But other than that, if you look on the left side, you have SLE, the collagen vascular diseases, vitamin B12 deficiency, infections, and other viral infections, all of which can cause pancytopenia. So it's important when we are working out a pancytopenia to try and first of all establish whether it's aplastic anemia. Too importantly, try and establish whether it's a primary or a secondary, because sometimes it's secondary, unless you take off the agent that is causing it, it will not help the disease to recover. So when we talk about aplastic anemia, one of the persons we remember is Paul Ehrlich, who won the Nobel Prize in 1908. Not for aplastic anemia, but he was the first person to describe a pregnant woman who came with aplastic anemia. Now, the clinical features that you look at are not very characteristic of aplastic anemia. So essentially, you will find patients with features of failure of the hematopoietic lines. So if you fail, erythroids are failing, you get anemia. If the platelets are low, you get bleeding. And because of neutropenia, you get infection. It's very important when you see a patient to look for presence of organomegaly or lymphadenopathy. If you see any of them, then you are worried that you're probably dealing with some other cause of aplastic anemia, and this is not an immune aplastic anemia, and you're probably more likely to be dealing with either a malignancy or an infection. When you look at the peripheral blood, you'd see a bland peripheral blood with neutropenia and pancytopenia, and you need a bone marrow for diagnosis. So when you look at a peripheral smear, you see this well hemoglobinized red cells, you see neutrophils in the peripheral blood, and you see these tiny dots here, which are actually your platelets. But when you look at a peripheral blood of a patient with aplastic anemia, the red cells are more sparse, they are not well hemoglobinized. You see more lymphocytes rather than neutrophils, and you hardly see any platelets. So this is somebody who's probably got severe aplastic anemia. What you need for diagnosis is a bone marrow. And there, essentially on the right side, you see a marrow which has got fat spaces and hematopoiesis that is going on in these cells, but they're all lost in aplastic anemia, and you see only fat spaces in the bone marrow of somebody with aplastic anemia. Now, when you look at the pathophysiology, you generally see that the cellular marrow is replaced by fat cells. And very importantly, there's a marked reduction in the stem cells, which are what are called as your 34 positive cells. There is also a reduction in the colony forming progenitor cells, which are your colony forming units. Even if you give growth factors, they do not respond. The long acting cells which form cultures do not work. And there is also some data to suggest that the bone marrow stroma may also be defective in aplastic anemia. Now, like I mentioned, you could have a direct effect of viruses, drugs, radiations, chemicals directly on the stem cell and progenitor compartment leading to aplastic anemia. But many times they act through immune mechanisms to actually cause aplastic anemia. Now, it is well known that there is a rush of cytotoxic T cells that form in the presence of an antigen. And now this antigen is still not clear what is the precipitating antigen, but there's a huge increase in the cytotoxic T cells. This leads to expansion of the T cell clones, which act on the hematopoietic cell and causes destruction of the hematopoietic cell. Over a period of time, there is exhaustion of the hematopoietic cells, and that leads on to aplastic anemia. Now, what is also becoming importantly clear is that aplastic anemia is not just a disease of immune system. There are other things that matter, and one of the most important things are the telomeres. Now, what are these telomeres? Telomeres are basically chromosomes. At the end of chromosomes, you have these specific telomeres which are present, which protect this DNA from shortening. But what is important is, as a part of the aging, the telomeres keep shortening, finally with every cell division, so that finally when the telomeres stop, the cell division stops and the cells die. Now it's clearly seen, and this is guarded by a set of enzymes and a set of genes. The enzymes are called telomerase, and the presence of telomerase prevents telomere shortening. What is clearly being seen in aplastic anemia is roughly in about 30 to 50% of patients, telomeres are short. And in some of them, there are actually mutations which cause shortening. So, which means that there are also other inherited forms of aplastic anemia, which are now slowly being identified, in which telomeres are being reduced in this group of patients. And these are the various genes which are associated with telomere shortening. Now, there's a whole group of diseases called as telomeropathies, which are associated with aplastic anemia, where you can have liver and pulmonary fibrosis, along with predisposition to hematological malignancies. And it's now seen that they run in families, and they can occupy any of these genetic defects can actually lead on to formation of this constellation of symptoms. Now, once we diagnose aplastic anemia, we need to gauge its severity. And that is based upon an old criteria called as the Kamita criteria, where we look at the bone marrow cellularity, and we look at the severity of the neutrophil platelet and the reticulocyte damage. So if your neutrophils are less than 500, platelets less than 20, and the reticulocyte count less than 20,000, along with a hypocellular marrow, it's called severe. If the neutrophil count is less than 200, it's called very severe. And if it does not fulfill this criteria, but there's aplastic anemia, it is called as non-severe aplastic anemia. Now, why is it important to distinguish these? We need to remember that severe and very severe aplastic anemia, if not treated, more than 70 to 80% will die within 1 year. So it's very important that we actively treat these patients with whatever therapy is available, and I'll come to that subsequently. Otherwise, they are likely to die if they don't have recovery of hematopoiesis. Non-severe works very slowly, so you may have a group of patients where you may not need therapy at all in the beginning until the blood counts drop and they start requiring transfusions. So the first step in the management of bone marrow failure is to establish that the diagnosis is correct. Now, one of the important things to remember is that when you have a patient with an acute lymphoblastic leukemia and you give steroids, which is normally given for pancytopenia, you pass through a phase where the blasts have been wiped out and the marrow hematopoiesis has not recovered. And so when you do a bone marrow at that point of time, you will actually find an aplastic marrow. So that patient does not have aplastic anemia. It's actually a partially treated ALL. So it's very important to get a good history. And if you find that the patient has recently been treated with steroids, sometimes we just wait for a month and see. And if it's ALL, truly the blast will come back. Sometimes you may not get a good aspirate, and then we call it aplastic anemia, which is actually not correct because there are other diseases where you cannot get an aspirate, and therefore a bone marrow biopsy is mandatory. You would look for stress cytogenetics in inherited bone marrow failures. I'll come to that. But what is very important is for cytogenetics to be sent to look for hypoplastic MDS. So in the medical wards, when you're seeing a patient with cytopenia or a pancytopenia, it's always important to try and take a sample for cytogenetics the first time. You remember that a bone marrow test is painful, and so we do not want to subject the patient again to a test just because you missed out on a sample. So it's very important that cytogenetics is sent for all patients with pancytopenia. So the management of aplastic anemia consists of two things. One is supportive, which consists of Paxil transfusion if the hemoglobin is less than 7, platelet transfusion, usually if the platelets are less than 10,000, or if there is bleeding or fever, and prop treatment of infection. But these are all only supportive. So what you need is specific measures to reconstitute or improve hematopoiesis, without which the patient will actually die. So the definite therapy includes stem cell transplantation, immunosuppression, and the use of androgens. These would be the three major groups of treatment. So the best treatment for any young patient, just some countries would take a cutoff at 40. We would take a cutoff of about 50. So for anybody below the age of 50 with aplastic anemia, the first thing would be to look and see, is there a HLA match donor? If that is there, going for a transplant is probably the best option. So it's very important that if you see a patient who's young, then and who is potential for transplant, we need to organize HLA typing as soon as possible with the relatives, usually siblings. Try and irradiate all blood products and avoid transfusion from first degree relatives so as to prevent alloimmunization. So this is data from around the world. This is from the Center for International Bone Marrow Transplant Registry. And generally, if you are less than 20 years, you have an 85% chance of cure. And if you're more than 20, you have a 70% chance of cure with a bone marrow transplant. But the reality in India is that it is different from what happens in the West. And that is mainly because there's a large time interval between diagnosis and a transplant. There are multiple reasons for that. Patients don't have access to healthcare. Even if they access healthcare, the cost is quite high. So they need time to try and arrange the finances, because of which they get multiple transfusions or they get admitted for infections. And all this leads out to higher rejection rates, higher mortality and morbidity during transplants, and leads to poor long-term survival. So we started transplants at CMC in 1986, and we did the first transplant for aplastic anemia in 1990. And we do about 120 allogeneic and about 40 to 50 autologous transplants. So this is data from our center. This is still December 2020, around 2,500 transplants. And aplastic anemia is the third most common indication for a transplant after thalassemia and acute myeloid leukemia. These patients are transplanted in these HEPA filtered rooms, which are presently right now on top of the A block on the ninth floor. These are each individual rooms which are HEPA filtered so as to prevent infection and keep sterility while they have a transplant. So we have done roughly about 400 transplants for aplastic anemia. We have modified our protocols as it goes along to suit an Indian purpose. And overall, if you look at this 346 sibling donor transplants, the overall outcomes are about 68%. We recently published our own data with the use of fludarabine and cyclophosphamide, where we have overall survivals of close to 75%. But what is important to look at the age. So if you were less than 20 years, you had an 80% chance of cure. 20 to 40 years, you had a 75% chance of cure. And if you're more than 40 years, you had a 60% chance of cure. So younger patient tends to do better than older patients. But what is striking is if you manage to take a patient up early for transplant. So if you have a low risk meant less than 20 transfusions, less than 3 months from diagnosis, no bleeding or active infections, no previous exposure to ATG, you have almost a 90% chance that you can cure this patient of the aplastic anemia. While if you have any of these risk factors, your chances of cure are only about 65%. So it's very important for us to try and see whether we can identify these patients early and take them up early in for a transplant, because you have close to a 90% chance that you can cure these patients. Now, only about 30% of patients who need a transplant will find a sibling donor. And so what do we do for the rest? One of the options is immunosuppressive therapy. So generally, we offer immunosuppressive therapy for people above the age of 50, or if they're below the age of 50 but do not have a compatible sibling donor, or those with non-severe aplastic anemia. Now, what is this anti-thymocyte globulin? This essentially consists of taking human thymocytes or T cells. Usually, you take the thymus that's obtained when they are doing cardiovascular surgery. They have to remove the thymus to access. Now, this thymus is mashed up and sort of injected into rabbits or horses. And then after a period of time, these rabbits and horses will form antibodies against the thymus. So these are antibodies against T cells, and this is then harvested. And that is what is finally given back to the patient. So in India, as of now, there is both. It can usually be taken from horses or from rabbits, but now there's a Chinese variant where you can even use pigs to actually get these anti-thymocyte globulin. Now, the drugs available in India are the Adgam and the Thymogam. This is the foreign brand, Pharmacia Upjohn. This is a generic Bharat Serum, which are both from equine. And there is a rabbit called as Thymoglobulin from Janssen. These are the three ATGs that are available in India. Generally, you give it for about 4 days. Now, one of the important things to remember is that this is an immunoglobulin that you've got from an animal. And so because of that, you will get a delayed type hypersensitivity reaction in terms of serum sickness. And so because of this, to prevent that, you would give corticosteroids from day 5 to day 14 as a prophylaxis against serum sickness. And then you would add cyclosporin to the ATG. So the treatment with ATG consists of ATG for 4 to 5 days, along with cyclosporin for about 6 months. Now with ATG, we need to be careful because it can cause anaphylaxis. It can cause severe hemolysis, fever, and chills. and it can cause chemical phlebitis if administered to a peripheral vein. So we always have to put in the central venous axis in order to give the ATG. They get admitted for these 5 days of injections. Subsequently, beyond that, they can be discharged. So what is the chances of cure? So this is data from around Europe, where roughly about 60 to 65% will respond. But importantly, remember that about 10 to 20% will relapse and about 10% will transform subsequently to either PNH, MDS, or acute myeloid leukemia. Now, this is data from our own center. This is about 780 patients who have received ATG over a period of close to 30 years. But if you are a non-severe aplastic anemia, you have a 70% chance of response. And with severe and very severe, it's about 50 to 60%. But what is characteristic is the age difference. So if you are a young child, you had only about a 35% chance of response as compared to the older people where close to a 60% chance of response is seen. What is this due to? We think that it's partly because there are other inherited forms of bone marrow failure which we are not recognizing by the standard test that we do, and that may be part of the reason why they are not responding to ATG. But the response in the people above the age of 15 are similar to what happens around the world. Now, we need to remember that unfortunately, both these treatment options are costly. Sibling donor transplant costs about 14 lakhs. ATG with cyclosporine costs about 10 lakhs. So what can we do for patients who cannot afford these treatment options? One needs to use immunosuppression with just cyclosporine alone. It is a potent drug which acts on the cyclophilin act-mediated immune activation and inhibits IL-2 and interferon gamma and prevents the apoptosis of hematopoietic cells. It is given at a dose of 5 mg per kg per day for about 6 months. Importantly, patients need to be monitored. Acute kidney injury is very common. They can get gum hypertrophy, they can get hypertension, and they can have a lot of hypertrichosis that can occur. Now, these are reversible, so it's important to monitor them and ensure that if the kidney is getting damaged, you stop the cyclosporine so that they improve. This is data on about 300 patients with cyclosporine that have been treated at our center. If you have a non-severe aplastic anemia, roughly about 70% show a response, while it's about 30 to 35% in those with severe and very severe aplastic anemia. Androgen started as the poor man's option because there are many patients who couldn't even afford cyclosporine, which costs roughly between 10 to 20,000 a month for about 6 months. There are two drugs that are commonly used. One is tanezolol and one is danazol, and roughly it costs between 2 to 5,000 per month. Now, responses are seen in about 20 to 30%. We cannot cure the disease, but in some patients, we can reach a stage where they become transfusion independent. The neutrophil count and the platelet count become good enough where they don't have recurrent infections and where they don't need platelet transfusions. But what is now being seen is that if you had a patient with the telomeropathy or who had telomere mutations, danazol seems to be useful in improving the blood counts in that group of patients. The main side effects are hepatotoxicity, so you have to keep a watch out for them. Now, there's a new kid on the block, which is the TPO receptor agonist, which is L-trombopag. It was first used in the treatment of ITP and showed to be useful. Subsequently, it's been shown that high doses of L-trombopag at a dose of 150 milligrams is useful in patients with aplastic anemia. And initially they showed that roughly about 30 to 40% patients who have failed immunosuppressive therapy could respond to L-trombopag. But what was remarkable is the study that if you added L-trombopag to a group of patients who had ATG and cyclosporine, your response rates went up from 60% to close to 90%. The problem is the L-trombopag adds about 6 to 8 lakhs to the cost. So if somebody can afford, it's worthwhile giving triple therapy because you have almost an 80 to 90% chance of having a response to this triple therapy. Now, while we talk about children with aplastic anemia, children or young adults, I would say, it's very important to remember that there is a group of aplastic anemia which can be hereditary and can present in early childhood, late childhood, adolescence, or young adults. Now, it's important to recognize them that because they're hereditary, and so importantly, they do not have an immune basis. If they do not have an immune basis, there is no point trying to treat them with either cyclosporin or with ATG because they're not likely to respond. So the only curative option available is a bone marrow transplant. Unfortunately, some of them have an abnormal sensitivity to chemotherapy drugs. And so it's important that even during a bone marrow transplant, you have to adjust the doses so that they don't have bad toxicity related to the drugs. And they also have a higher risk of secondary malignancies. The classical prototype of this malignancy is Fanconi anemia, which was described by a Swiss pediatrician called Guido Fanconi in 1927. Where they describe three brothers with pancytopenia and physical abnormalities. And what you characteristically see along with the pancytopenia in Indian patients, what you characteristically see is short stature. So you see a family walk in, you'll find that the parents and the other siblings are all have good height and this child is stunted. They have hyperpigmentation of the face and the oral mucosa. They have elfin-like facies. And when you do radiology, you find skeletal and renal abnormalities. So this is one of our children with Fanconi anemia. You see this long elfin-like faces that they have. They have these Caffioli spots. And if you look, the skeletal abnormalities can vary. This could be absent thumb. It could be a doubled phalanx. This could be an appendageal phalanx that can be present. And you see this horseshoe kidneys. You can see ectopic kidneys in this called malrotation of the gut. And very importantly, if you go back into history, many of them get treated for cardiac abnormalities during the infancy. PDA, VSD, and ASD are commonly seen during the period and they get treated for it, but they may not have pancytopenia. They may have mild anemia with a macrocytosis, which is sort of ignored. And then subsequently they present with pancytopenia and Fanconi. Now, it's very important to clearly distinguish them, and that is based upon a test called a stress cytogenetics, and that shows it demonstrates the absence of DNA repair mechanism. So normally, if you take peripheral blood lymphocytes and you expose them to either mitomycin C or dihydroxybutane, what happens is these lymphocytes break apart. But after a period of time, when you continue culturing them, they will all grow back and form your normal edge-on-edge joining because the DNA repair mechanisms are adequate. If the DNA repair mechanisms are inadequate, then they can join in different areas and that forms these triradials, the tetraradials, which you see, which is characteristic of Fanconi anemia. Now, generally, you do a transplant for them. We have done close to about 50 transplants here, and you have about 75% cure rates. Now, the doses that use for transplant in Fanconi anemia are very different from the doses that use in aplastic anemia, and you just give about 20% of the dose as you would do in aplastic anemia. In patients who do not have a donor, you can use a combination of androgen and steroids. It can improve hematological values, but they're not curative. And allogeneic BMT improves only the hematopoietic failure. So we need to remember that these patients are at a risk for developing malignancies in other areas, especially squamous cell carcinoma of the bladder, of the GI tract, of the palate. Now, these do not reduce when we do a bone marrow transplant. The bone marrow transplant only cures the hematopoietic failure that occurs in this group of patients. The other congenital form of aplastic anemia is dyskeratosis congenita, and it has a diagnostic triad of ectodermal, endodermal, and mesodermal abnormalities. The ectoderm is usually nail dystrophy and skin hyperpigmentation. The endoderm is the mucous membrane leukoplakia, and the mesoderm is bone marrow failure. This is one of our patients who's got this hyperpigmentation. This is the leukoplakia. You see this characteristic hyperpigmentation and darkening of the hands and the patchy pigmentation which occurs over the back. Here again, the only treatment is an allogeneic transplant and can cure in about 75% of patients. Now, coming away from inherited disorders, the next would be an acquired disorder, which is called as paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria. Now, this is an acquired clonal disorder, which can actually present in three different ways. It can present with just intravascular hemolysis alone. It can present with venous thrombosis, usually the intra-abdominal or the cerebral veins. And it can present with pancytopenias and show a marrow, which is hypocellular, similar to aplastic anemia. Now, they have a deficiency of the GPA anchoring proteins, because of which they are abnormally sensitive to complement-mediated lysis. And they have what are called as PGA mutations with deficiency of the decay accelerating factor and the MIRL. So you look for a history of classically, patient goes to sleep in the night, and in the night when they get up to pass urine early morning, they find this hemolysis that is occurring. They have pancytopenia. Earlier, we used to use the HAMS and sucrose lysis test and urine for hemosiderin. One of the problems with the HAMS and sucrose lysis being that if you had a patient who came in with a recent transfusion, then you could probably get these wrong. So what is considered now as the gold standard is to do flow cytometry to look for specific antigens which may be absent, that is the CD55 and the 59, that you look on granulocytes, erythrocytes, and monocytes. So this is looking at, this is a patient where we are looking at the red cells. So this is what happens with, this is a negative control where you look at this area, which is negative, and in the control RBCs, that is a nice peak showing that CD59 is nicely available. But when you look at the patient at the same area, if you look, you find that the patient's RBCs do not show much of CD59. It means that they are CD59 deficient, which means that he probably has PNH. Now you can use either CD59 or CD55. Now, if you are transfused and you come, then it is difficult to look at the red cells because the red cells may belong to the donor who's donated the blood. So you can look at the neutrophils. So this is the control neutrophils, which has showed a good peak with CD59. And if you look at the patient, where the peak should be, this it is almost completely absent. So this means that the patient's neutrophils are also 59 negative. So this is consistent with paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria. So how do you treat that? When you have a patient who comes with an acute hemolysis, you can give your glucocorticoids, normally between 0.25 to 1 milligram per kg per day. You give it for about 5 to 7 days till it responds, and then you rapidly taper and stop it. You put them on danazol or stanozolol because they are believed to help in complement inhibition, and they may help in stabilizing the complement activation. And because these patients lose iron, you need to put them on iron replacement. The latest new drug is, because it works through the complement pathway, you have an anti-complement antibody called eculizumab, which targets the CD5 complement and helps in reducing the hemolysis in about 70 to 80%. But one of the problems is that it doesn't clear the primary problem. It just tackles it at the fag end in terms of how the complement is activated. So unless you are able to take it lifelong, once you stop it, the hemolysis will restart all over again. The only permanent cure is a bone marrow transplant, and the usual indications for a bone marrow transplant in somebody with PNH is if there is severe bone marrow failure, if there's recurrent life-threatening thromboembolic disease, or if there is refractory transfusion-dependent hemolytic anemia, not responding to danazol or responding to steroids. Generally, the cure rates are in the region of 50 to 60% because a lot of them have thrombotic complications and complications related to microangiopathy during a transplant. Now, the last group of disorders is again an acquired group of disorders with present with cytopenia or a pancytopenia, but unlike aplastic anemia, do not have a hypocellular marrow, but have a cellular marrow. So they have peripheral blood cytopenia with red cells, white cells, platelets all reduced. They have a hypercellular marrow. They have dysplasia. And what is very important is the fact that a lot of them can actually transform to acute myeloid leukemia. So this is actually many patients a pre-leukemic condition, which down a period of time can transform to acute myeloid leukemia. So these are some of the characteristic features that you can see in the red cells, in the white cells. So these are ring forms. You can see Pelgehue. You can see a single large megakaryocytes. You can see micromegs. These are characteristic features of dysplasia that you can see in the erythroid, myeloid, and the megakaryocytic lines. Now, to say that there is dysplasia, at least 10% of cells in the age should show some dysplastic changes. Now, there is a broad overlap. So you can have MDS, which overlaps with AML, which overlaps with PNH. So many MDS patients have a PNH clone. MDS overlaps with aplastic anemia, and there is an MDS with an MPD or a myeloproliferative disorder overlap. Now, this was the original FAB classification based upon whether it was single lineage or multi-lineage, and based upon how many blasts that were there, it was characterized into RA, RARS, excess blast with transformation, and CMML. But now this is the 2016 revision looking at whether it is a single lineage dysplasia, a multiple lineage dysplasia, excess of blast, and they have recognized a new entity called as a 5q deletion. Now there are some clinical variants which have not yet come into the classification which we see in India. One is what is called as a hypocellular MDS. So unlike the standard MDSs which have a cellular or a hypercellular marrow, this has a very hypocellular marrow, which is very similar to aplastic anemia. And the only ways you can try and distinguish is based upon whether there is increased reticulin, increased CD34 staining, and then you do cytogenetics to look for specific MDS-like abnormalities. The second is MDS with severe reticulin fibrosis that you can see in a few patients, which may be autoimmune in nature. Now, the international IPSS scoring system was formulated based upon the presence of blast, karyotype, and cytopenias. Now, why was this done? This was done mainly because we need to remember in the West, MDS is a disease of the elderly, that the median age is about 65 years. And so you needed to sort of decide in which patients will you be aggressive and which patients will you be sort of more palliative in terms of therapy. And this was a good way of looking at it. So using a combination of marrow blasts, the karyotype and the peripheral cytopenia, and giving a number to each of them, you had what was a low risk, which was 0, intermediate 1.5 to 1, intermediate 2, 1.5 to 2, and high, which was more than 2.5. And when you put them together, you realize that in the intermediate risk and the high risk group, within 5 months to 1 year, a lot of them were transformed to AML. And their overall survival was very poor. While in this low risk and intermediate risk, the time to transformation to AML was close to 5 years. So because of that, these two became what is called as low risk MDS, low and intermediate one, and intermediate two and high risk was called as high risk MDS. Now in the high risk MDS, you needed to approach them differently and look at curative options. Otherwise, you would end up transforming to acute myeloid leukemia. So what are the treatment options available? In the low risk, you can use immunomodulatory drugs like lenalidomide and thalidomide. You can use cytokines like erythropoietin and colony stimulating factors. In hypoplastic MDS, you can use ATG cyclosporin, and you can use azacitidine and decitabine. If you failed all of them, or at least two lines of therapy, then only you would consider a stem cell transplant. The high risk, on the other hand, is very different. And because they've got a high risk of transformation to leukemia, you would consider a stem cell transplant very early. If they needed time to go for a transplant, you would treat them with hypomethylating agents like azacitidine and decitabine. Now, one of the characteristic diseases that you see in MDS is what is called as a 5Q syndrome. And it's important to identify that it's usually either by FISH or by cytogenetics, because if you use lenalidomide in those patients, you had almost a 60 to 70% chance that you could get them transfusion independent, and 30 to 40% chance that you could get them cytogenetically normal. So you could potentially cure a patient with 5Q even using lenalidomide. You would need to give it for about 12 months, but importantly, many of them may lose response on stopping the drug. So when we look at low-risk MDS, this is the general way we would manage. If you had a Del-5Q, we would definitely consider lenalidomide. If they fail lenalidomide, you would look at erythropoietin and G-CSF and subsequently consider a transplant. If you had a non-Del-5Q, we would either use lenalidomide and thalidomide. Here, there are only 30% responses. You could also consider using erythropoietin if the EPO levels are low, and then you would consider a transplant. While in hypocellular MDS, you treat them similar to a non-severe aplastic anemia. So you can treat them with ATG cyclosporin, and if they fail, then go for a transplant. Well, if you look at a high-risk MDS, you decide at the beginning, is this a patient who can go for a transplant or not? Now, if you were somebody who was 65, 70 years, you would say they're not a standard transplant candidate. So you would consider giving them drugs to keep the disease under control for a period of time. But if they were younger and they had a transplant option, we would look for an allogenic donor, and you may bridge them with hypomethylating agents till they go for a transplant. So I'll stop by saying the take-home messages. I think what's most important is that a correct diagnosis is very critical. You need a bone marrow aspirate and a biopsy. You need to have a good history, which will help you in telling, are you dealing with a drug-related cytopenia or not? We clearly need to distinguish inherited from acquired aplastic anemia, because the treatment options that are available are different. Stem cell transplant is the treatment of choice in both, but immunosuppressive therapy is also reasonable in adults with aplastic anemia. Low-risk MDSs, you can treat with lenalidomide. You can use hypomethylating agents in high-risk MDS, and young patients with MDS should have a transplant, because that is the only thing which is curative. So with this, I will stop. And I will be happy to see if there are any questions which I can take.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot, sir, for that very elaborate lecture on the bone marrow failure. I think it covered an aspect of diagnosis approach and the management perspective. Hope it was very useful for everyone who has been listening. Please feel free to have any questions to be dropped down in the chat box, or you can unmute yourself and speak to sir. So in the COVID scenario, how is our bone marrow transplant settings being affected? And also want to know about the vaccination protocol for patients who have underwent bone marrow transplant.
So we are still proceeding with transplant in general, except for some elective transplant. For example, like thalassemia, that would be a group where we can put them on transfusion protocols and wait for a few months before we take them up for a transplant. But those with acute leukemia, aplastic anemia, we are generally going ahead with transplants. So last year, actually, we did both allogenic and autologous. During the COVID, we did close to about 180 to 200 transplants. And we are planning to go the same way. Now, in terms of COVID vaccination, we are advising everybody who's on chemotherapy to have a vaccine. For an allogenic transplant, the recommendations are that we should wait for at least 3 months after an allogenic transplant to have a vaccination. But beyond that, it is safe. So everybody, we are advising.
post transplant upon steroids, is there any indication of any doubling of steroids or anything for the work?
No, we are not making any change at all.
Sure. There's a question in the chat box.
I saw that. So is there a role for conservative management? Yes, there is definitely a role. So in patients with MDS who have only borderline counts, are not transfusion dependent and not infected, many times we would just observe and see. Only when the hematopoietic failure worsens and they become transfusion dependent, or the cytopenia becomes severe enough where they require admission for infections or bleeding because of thrombocytopenia, then only we would actually treat them. So there is a group of patients who have only mild hematopoietic failure where we could just observe, and they may even go for a number of years before they actually require any treatment.
Thank you, sir. Any further questions? If any queries, you can either mail to hemat@cmcvalo.ac.in or maybe med2@cmcvalo.ac.in also if any further questions. Shall we wait for another 2 minutes to see if any questions?
Sure. So I think one of the, since they're all medicine PGs there, one of the things I would just say is that if you have a patient with cytopenia who's admitted in your medicine wards, because recently I think I know at least of 3 patients who had a marrow done and no cytogenetics or flow was collected and we had to do it all over again. So I think I would say, please discuss with hematology about what you want to do in terms of the marrow, because you need to remember bone marrow procedure is very painful.
Yes,
and so if we end up having to do it all over again, so somebody with a cytopenia where we are suspecting a hematological malignancy or a hematological disorder as a part of the differential diagnosis, we should collect a sample for cytogenetics and flow. And if you talk to the hemat.call, we would tell them to process it only after the bone marrow aspirate report is ready. But that helps us in not needlessly having to repeat marrows again. So that is one thing I think you people should definitely look at.
Sure. If no further questions, we'll wind up for today. The lecture will soon be uploaded in the Department of Medicine YouTube website. Thanks again, sir, for agreeing to take this lecture and making it very simple for us. I hope everyone is clear about the approach in terms of bone marrow failure. Sir, I think there's one more question in the chat box.
So how does isolated thrombocytopenia with hypoplastic marrow come under MDS2 with no blasts? It could come under MDS or it could come under evolving aplastic anemia. So some of the things we look to see is, are the megakaryocytes reduced or adequate in the marrow? That helps in distinguishing between aplastic anemia and MDS. 2, importantly, are there mast cells seen in the marrow? If there are mast cells seen, you're more likely to be dealing with aplastic anemia, non-severe form of aplastic anemia, rather than a myelodysplastic syndrome. So when we look at unilineage dysplasia in MDS, it could either be the red cells, it could be the white cells, or it could be the megakaryocytes also. So there is an MDS with unilineage dysplasia, which may present with just thrombocytopenia alone, without any blasts in the marrow.
Sure, thank you, sir. Any further questions? So I think so we'll wind up for today. Thanks again, sir.
Sure. Thank you very much.
Bye, sir. Thanks, everyone.